Dr. Nivedita Manokaran, you're a dermatologist and venereologist from India, and you live in Sydney and work in sexual and reproductive medicine and HIV medicine. Yeah? You're extremely passionate about women's health, youth, sexual and reproductive health, and contraception. Trained by Family Planning Australia, you believe that sex education is a very essential need in India, as everywhere else, among youngsters, and are keen to give back what you missed as a youngster and a young doctor who trained in India. You
Yes.
run an Instagram page. How do you say your page? Dr. Nai?
Dr. Nivi, actually.
Dr. Nivi, okay. Dr. underscore Nivi dash hyphen Antaboos, right?
Yes.
And a Facebook page which you call Antaboo, which you'll talk
Antaboo.
about a lot because it's quite fascinated with both of them. And you
Thank
use
you.
this as a platform to educate about STIs, mental health, women empowerment, and everything which is taboo, which we're going to untaboo today. So
Yes.
thank you so much for coming here with us and being with us here today. So before I go into the work that you do, let me just explore a little bit about you as a person, because I was quite fascinated to read that, you know, dancing, baking, Zumba, origami, artist. I mean, I was carrying a complex over there. I said, oh my God, I need to do something with my life. But Nivedita, if I was to ask you that, just which are the three words that you would choose, which would define the essence that you are? You know, not what you do, but the essence of Nivedita.
I don't want to sound like I'm boasting, but I think I am kind, compassionate, and giving.
Very, very important. And why do you choose these words?
I do find myself doing a lot of things for a lot of people. I think it's a nature of mine. And I actually was born a single child and I had no siblings. And I grew up with a lot of friends and a lot of cousins, right? And I didn't have many people like to stay with me or to be with me. I don't know if it is something I started off initially to keep people to myself. You know, I didn't know, I remember thinking, you know, if I give this to them, they'll stay with me. Or if I give, you know, if you give things, they will stay. And it kind of started off like a habit like that, just, you know, just pretty much giving things or doing things for people. And then as I grew up as a teenager, I started thinking like, you know, some people started saying, what's wrong with you? Why do you keep just, you know, why do you do this? And I did kind of question myself. And then eventually I went through a lot of thinking. And actually, it's surprising you asked me that. And I have this poster in my room I have to show.
Yes, please.
So that is for me, because I keep questioning why I do this. And then eventually I have learned that I do things for people, not because of who they are or what they do in return for me, but because of who I am.
Beautiful.
So this is
Brilliant.
so it's strange how you asked me, because it took a while for me to figure out why I actually, like, you know, do things. And to be honest, you know, I'm a full-time working mom of two boys. And I do this Instagram page, which is almost like a full-time job, to be honest. And I would like to do and support every NGO that is going to talk about sex or sexual health or anything, sexual assault, mental health, HIV, medicine, untaboo HIV, anything. I'm
Brilliant.
Going to be, yeah, I'm going to be here and I'm going to be happy to do whatever that takes that I can give. And I think I want to say that's going to be very one-sided, to be honest. It's totally my wanting to give it to people. So
yes.
Anybody can actually, yes, access anything like webinars or seminars or anything that I can help. I'd be more
Brilliant.
Than happy to do it in my time.
Brilliant, brilliant. I would love to share the work that we are doing, and the actual, what we're trying to do is actually to create collective action. We're trying to put together people, like-minded people, who would actually come together. And, you know, we can create these conversations which kind of have a ripple effect, and they kind of have a long lasting, and they permeate the families, because that's where we really need to reach, isn't it? We
yeah,
need to
definitely.
Reach inside the families and start having this conversation. So let me start with your family. I mean,
yeah,
you
sure.
come from a long line of doctors, as you say,
yes,
and then you
surgeons
chose to,
particularly.
particularly, and then you chose to practice what you're practicing. So do you want to talk a little about your journey to reach here?
Yes, absolutely. So I come from a family of surgeons, and I'm mm-hmm. the seventh or eighth generation doctor in my family, to be honest.
Wow.
And I'm a single child. So my mother was a surgical oncologist and my father is a plastic surgeon. And I was born, I think there was I don't think they even asked me or there was a question of what she's going to be. I think it was very obvious that she will be a doctor.
Okay.
And seeing all the surgeons, I feel like I had a great passion for surgery, to be honest. And I showed great interest in that as well. Mm-hmm. But having both parents as surgeons and, you know, working hard, doing long days and shifts and stuff like that, somehow my father kind of, he's not logged in today. I was hoping he did. somehow my father kind of convinced me to do, you know, dermatology, because I was telling him I wanted to do surgery and become a plastic surgeon like him. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, dermatology is good because I do like skin. Skin is my passion and I love beauty. And so he said, why don't you do something light like dermatology? And then you can do a bit of cosmetic surgery and choose to do a little bit more lighter work, he said. So I said, okay, not a bad idea, because I love skin. Skin is fantastic. So I did dermatologist, and when I was doing dermatology, the other degree that comes along with the dermatology degree in India is venereology. And that's where you get, and so you get taught about STDs and stuff like that. And it was amazing when I grew up as a young doctor, the amount of STDs we would see. And it was all about diagnosing it. We'll be so excited when we see gonorrhea or chlamydia and herpes. It was all about the diagnosis and how smart you were in diagnosing it. But I could see like a big chunk was being missed is the conversation. And as a young doctor in living and raised in India, I didn't quite recognize it then. I should say I didn't feel like I was missing something at all. And I didn't think we were ever taught to ask people anything. STD clinic was run, a lot of STIs were recognized. And that's about that. And we were not supposed to ask anything more than that. And we could, and it was a fascinating field. And I thought, how come nobody's talking about this? And I did study in a co-education college, and I should say we were quite forward. We kind of knew, you know, we people were dating at that time. It was all very whoosh, but, you know, people were dating at that time. People were physically active and sexually active. And we had friends and other people who shared these things, you know, and nobody spoke about it. If something was wrong or I really cannot, I don't know what, I mean, now I'm thinking, you know, if one of us actually really had an STI or got pregnant, or I don't know, like what could have, you know, happened. And though I didn't think of it then when I actually was the doctor on the other side of the counter. And then I realized when I came here and started working that what a big gap, you know, it is at back home. And that's why I feel like we should go back and change this. And I don't know if I can do it as one person, but it's a start. It's a beginning. It's a whole community of us who's going to try to do this. So I feel like we all should be a part in doing it. So that's my journey.
I mean, conversations, Nivedita, are so, so critically important. And just like listening to you, it's once again coming to the forefront about how each one of us over here is really walking the edge of the precipice. No, we have no idea about what's like really one misstep and we're going to fall into the silence and we'll have no way to talk and no way to know and to ask. And but tell me one thing, I mean, talking about conversations and talking about family, and then you came from the doctor's family. Did you have conversations at home?
No.
I mean, not at all.
Not at all. I think I was kind of a rebel, to be honest, to have taken... Mm-hmm. I mean, sexual health and being on a social media all the time talking about sex and assault. This is what I do for a living. It took a while, I think, for my father even to call me a sexual health specialist from a dermatologist. Mm-hmm. I think my family itself took a long time. They take pride in calling me a dermatologist, which is great. I get it. But honestly, I am a sexual health specialist and I do sexual and reproductive work. So I am a sexual health clinician more than anything. So it took a long time, even just for my family to say, what does she do? Like, she does sexual health, she does HIV, you know, it took such a long time for people to accept that that's the job she does. But I think they're proud of me now. But
yeah, I'm sure they are. It's you know, it's really not linked to what how proud they are of you or how whether they accept you. What it's just this whole thing, the silence that surrounds this, this conspiracy of silence that surrounds any conversation which has starts with SEX. You know,
I mean, absolutely. I don't remember having that. Like, I lost my mother when I was very young. I should say I lost her when I was 21. But still, I think, you know, somewhere between 15, 16 to 21, there should have been a lot of conversation. At least nowadays, you know, you think that there should be a lot of conversation. Clearly, yeah. I don't think we, I mean, we spoke about, like, you know, boyfriends or, you know, things like that. But I cannot recall or remember talking about sex at all. It was never questioned. Mm-hmm. It's not even a thing that is, that you can talk about. It's like, it's assumed that you don't do anything till you get married. And nobody wants to talk about it, you know. And I think even if there is any suspicion, they still rather be in denial than address it.
That's so true. I mean, and how do you think you're kind of changing it in your life? Like, now that you realize the importance of it and the work that you do, how are you actually shifting it in your own personal life going
Perfect.
Forward?
It's a very good question because I have a 13-year-old boy and I have an 8-year-old as well. It started
both off boys or a boy
both
and a
boys.
Girl.
I have two boys.
Both boys.
Okay. Yes. And it is surprising because in year four, in my eldest, in year four, that's right. They did a sex ed class and they called all the parents and the kids. He was 9 years old then, and sex education for a 9 year old was unacceptable. And I was, as a parent, I wasn't ready though. I was thinking, he's nine, he's my baby, you know. But then it was, and to be honest, I declined that invitation. And I did not go for that, you know, and I thought 9 is too much. We shouldn't go for it. But of course, there are parents who were here who've done it well and before. So there were a whole bunch of other children from the class who went and parents who went. And then the next day morning, whether you go or not, whether you took your child or not, he knew everything because his friends went. And they came back with a whole bunch of information about how this happens and, you know, and my son came back saying, oh my God, you know, Ma, I believe this is how it happens. I can't believe you and Daddy did this. You know, he was in shock. And then I thought it probably would have been a good idea if we did it together. It would have been a nice thing to do as a parent. And now he knows it anyway, like, you know. So the next year I went with him. He was 10. So of course there's a whole bunch of 10-year-old and parents. So I thought, okay, fine. There's no more tabooing this thing. I should be a different parent. So I was straight there in front. And there was this fantastic sex ed class for the 10-year-old, I should say. Like, there was no beating around the bush. There was no beating around. Yeah, there's no beating around the bush. There was a photo of a naked boy. There was a photo of a naked girl. And there was the next photo of how there was a penis inside a vagina. It was as simple as that. It was three shots and you're like, done. There's no more. It was very simple. But what they tried to emphasize there was everything that this body and that body does has to be essence or an outcome of love. Whatever this body and that body does is an outcome of affection. And whatever this body or that body does is always consensual. Both the people should agree to that happening, whether it is kissing or whether it's holding hands or whether it goes to as far as sex. It has to be accepted by both of you. You know, it can be as small as they spoke about coffees and movies and popcorn and dates. And they took them up to candlelight dinners, which can lead to sex. And if it does, it is a happy feeling. It shouldn't hurt anyone. And nobody should feel uncomfortable after that. It was very beautifully, it was very straightforward. Like first three slides, they broke the silence. So that was great. And then the amount they spoke about the importance behind these things, you know, the consent and how this has to be consensual and how there has to be more liking or attraction when this thing happens to two bodies, whether it is two girls or two boys or, you know, it was beautiful. I thought it was a, it was
so,
a half
so they
an
broke
hour.
That heteronormative structure as well. They broke open that as well.
Yes, it was a few slides and I thought, they broke it so easily. There was no beating around the bush. You know, there was no 2.5 hours explanation of saying usually or in those days men had sex with women, but these, no. There was no such thing. So there was, nothing. It was very simple. Yes, if this is body, that is a body and this is your body parts. And this is how it works. This is how you have babies. And then they said, you can have this with men, you can have this with women, depending on who you're attracted to. But the bottom line is, you have to be attracted. You have to have an attraction. You have to have a liking. And it has to be consensual. And I thought that was very good because they kind of covered child abuse, didn't they? They kind of slided it in saying, they kind of slided it in one slide saying, if you feel like you don't want to do it, you don't like it, or if you're forced, then it is not okay. That's not normal.
Yeah, just speak up.
Just speak up.
And they gave them the language about their body parts without any shame or judgment associated with it. Isn't that brilliant?
Yeah, nothing. And then they had pictures which showed pimples and hair in the armpits and groin and explained puberty again very quickly, to be honest. And there was a fantastic explanation also about periods. And there were like so many boy kids and their mums sitting there and so many of their female classmates sitting there. And they just broke the whole, you know, embarrassment of just like that. You know, there's no boy, you know, oh, you're going to face this girl tomorrow in the class. They're speaking about periods and pads, nothing. It was all broken and said, this is something that girls go through and it's very painful for some. There's a lot of blood that's going through. They could be exhausted. So, you know, this is what you have to accept and be mindful and show some sympathy and empathy if that's needed. It was a fantastic 45 minutes.
How brilliant.
They said that changed my life and I thought that's fantastic. So that's how me and my 10-year-old then broke the whole thing of it. And then he asked me, you know, I have my badge saying sexual health physician and he asked me, what does this sexual health mean? What do you do? And then, so I've spoken to him about the kind of job I do. And I specifically do youth health, where I see people from 13 to 14 years old. Some 14, 15 year old with terminations and, you know, contraception and sexual assault and abuse. So I see a lot like that. And I'm thinking, I mean, they are the age of my child. And it does affect me, you know, a lot. But I really want to give back. And I'm thinking, you're like my child, to be honest. And a lot of them have drug and alcohol issues because of their background and exposure. So there's so much I do. So I explain all this to myself. Like, I'm very straightforward. I talk to my children straightforward about all of this. And what's surprising is my 8-year-old is quite tuned. He's very tuned about this. And he's a bit confused about the word sex, I should say. He doesn't quite... Things like periods when mummy's, you know, is having a bad tummy ache or, you know, they're really nice. Like in the sense they get me hot water bags and that's the day when we're going to have Maggi noodles and not a big meal. So just getting them used to the norm, just teaching them some sympathy and empathy and making things norm, you know. And sometimes, you know, a couple of days before, if I'm grumpy or really, you know, teary or something, you know, my eldest will come and say, are you okay? Do you want, you know, you can see that he wants to. It's so nice. And I feel like that's a big change. I feel like that's a big change. I don't think my family has ever done that, though I was a girl child. But I feel like I'm quite forward in that way. And my kids are quite tuned. And my eldest now helps me a lot of with putting stuff on Instagram, things and all, you know. Stuff, he's only 13. So he's tuned.
Yeah, I saw some of your reels. I saw some of your reels. But before I go there, I want to ask you another question, which usually gets ignored a lot, Nivedita, because... I mean, we talk about this is great what you just shared with me, but what does get ignored very often and I think it's like really connected to sexual abuse then later going on, is this whole concept and understanding of desire and pleasure. Mm-hmm. Much of the guilt that stays with people in positive or negative situations is this whole experience of pleasure or desire, right? Is that something that you think we need to talk to children, and how early do we need to talk to them about it?
Absolutely, absolutely. So when I started doing this work, we do see child sexual abuse in really young age, as even sometimes 4-year-old and 5-year-olds, to be honest.
Absolutely.
And it can happen in childcare or preschool situation. A lot of the time it happens with the trusted party. It's not a random person that comes and does that, you know.
Yeah.
So it is very, very important. And we encourage people to talk to their children about what is private parts and mm-hmm. what should be done with it and stuff that really early. And I think I had this conversation with my children when they were going ready to go to, you know, preschool and school around 4 or 5 years old. Mm-hmm. It's a very, you don't have to elaborate too much. All you need to say is, these are your private bits and mm-hmm. you can touch it, because, you know, you want to normalize that them mm-hmm. exploring and touching is not a shameful thing. You know, that's how early actually you should start that. You can't say, mm-hmm. don't touch it, because now we're trying to normalize masturbation. And now we're yes. trying to normalize, you know. So
yes.
they are private parts. Yes, you can touch mm-hmm. it. Yes, mommy can mm-hmm. touch it when I'm giving a shower, maybe. And mm-hmm. occasionally, if something is wrong with it, your doctor is allowed to see it if you give permission.
Mm-hmm.
But without your permission, nobody is allowed to touch it or see it, and you are allowed to say no. And I've also told them, it's very important to tell them that if that happens, you have mm-hmm. to come and tell mommy or daddy or your trusted person. It can be mm-hmm. a teacher, it can be anybody. It doesn't, I mean, sometimes if your mom, you're not close to them, but you spend a lot of the time with your nanny in the evening, let's say, you mm-hmm. must be able to come and tell that to your trusted person, because mm-hmm. we will want to help you. If you, the minute, most of the times children don't come up with this, or people don't come up with this, is because they take a long time to understand what's going on.
Yes.
They don't know. They're a bit confused about this. Did it seemed wrong, but is it wrong and all that? And also because it's private bits, they mm. start thinking, are my parents going to judge me?
Oh.
You know, that's the biggest fear. Is mommy going to get angry with me? So a lot of the times they worry about how we react. It's not even about how they have gone through. That that is a bit confusing in the beginning. Uh-huh. You know, if it's just like a very young child, you know, is confused. It was not penetration, but just touching or something. They're confused. But a lot of the time it's more stressful is for the fact that they can't open up to their loved ones because they're scared. They're scared of being judged. So I think we as parents really have to start very early, 4 or 5 years. Like I said, there's different age for everything. But mm-hmm. at a very young age, when you're leaving them in childcare and school, if you want them to know this is your private part, not anybody can touch your seat without your permission. It is such a simple thing. And I think that should be said very
But you know, very,
very
often, Nivedita, what happens is that when you're talking about masturbation, or when you're talking about the child discovering how they feel when they touch the private parts, or when they're feeling it happen, you know, they discover that huge, fuzzy, warm feeling that they're going through, for which they have no words, but they like it. So they want to experiment
Do
and
it
explore
again.
Even more. But the parents get so worried. They get so scared.
They
are
they
just so confused. Is this the right thing to do? Should I encourage them to do? Should I stop them to do? Sometimes, and if they are not sorted enough, then it just goes into shaming them or
policing
them.
So
just talk a little more about that a little bit, because that's a very, very important discussion that we need to have with parents.
Yes. So I just want to say, so all of us, whether men or women, we all have hormones that go through, and there is a bit of a hormone, like just to understand physiology, not to get very technical, you know, there's a bit of hormones that goes up and down, and a lot of the hormones give us a good feeling. It's actually a good feeling hormone, you know, and especially when you have a sexual arousal, or when you're trying to, you know, the hormone, the dopamine is the hormone that is secreted, and it's actually a happy hormone, right? And the hormone, and actually gives you a sense of confidence. It also gives you a sense of self-esteem, right? So feeling your parts or looking at your parts in the mirror and then feeling it actually kind of builds self-esteem for people, gives them that pleasure, gives the secretion of that hormone, and it's actually a good thing, right? So it is not just purely, I mean, I think the problem also is people see sex as a perversion, you know, they think, you know, talking about sex or masturbation or any other kind of sex or using vibrators or anything, I think it's all connected to pervert, right? It's all perversion. And they feel like, oh God, what, you know, they shame it, they dirty it so quickly. But honestly, I think that's what we need to change. We have to change the attitude of people and try to tell them that this is not perversion. This is normal physiology. And this actually has evidence that there are good hormones that bring warmth, bring self-esteem. So if your child is locked up, especially a teenager, you will find them locked up in the room for a long time, right? And I always like feel like, I think parents should know, knock a teenager's room, you know, like it's okay for them to explore. It's okay for them to try, you know, a teenager shower can take longer than normal people shower. Of course they're exploring, you know, don't go there and stand knocking at the door saying, what are you doing? I mean, you might know what they're doing, but there's no, you know, just, I think it's acceptance. I think it is normal physiology. So in every age, in fact, testosterone surge, like in boys, really start when they're 3 to 4 years old. So you see 3-year-old children like waking up from sleep in the morning with an erect penis. Yes. You can, you know, you see that. And for some people, actually, it hurts. Some children like wake up and say, oh, it's hurting because it is erect, because that happens really young, 3 to 4 year old. And this, and at that point, if you say, oh, stop it, don't talk about it, don't touch it, it just, you know, it says, oh, what's wrong? Is something wrong? Shouldn't I be talking about my private parts? Instead, I think, you know, you just give it some time, it settles in, or you can encourage them to go and pee and say, why don't you go to the toilet and pee and, you know, come back in a couple of minutes, and then it goes down. So I think it is important for all of us to recognize normal physiology and not get scared about it and understand the benefits of it. Especially self-esteem is so important, and I think masturbation and looking at yourself naked in the mirror and, you know, actually admiring yourself even is actually a good thing. You know, it gives you so much positive energy and self-confidence. It builds up so much in especially in today's, you know, social media time, when there's things like that, really want to be in a place where you're able to admire yourself, you know, do all of that. So this is very important part to accept it.
Brilliant. Thanks, Nivedita. I think this is a really important conversation to be had. And I hope many parents who would be tuning in and listening to this live today or later would actually take something back from this when they're talking about to their children and about their children. But there's something that you also mentioned when you spoke about her, the difference between when you said, when you took the sexual history of people in India as a young doctor, as opposed to how you were taking the sexual history when you moved to Australia, that whole shift, I would just like you to talk a little about that, because something about here where we're not able to talk about anything beginning with SEX and taking any, even considering that the people that we are examining have anything to do or are sexual beings at all. You know, they're everybody for us is like asexual. That is it, period. And that is the way to be chased. So and that leads to a lot of problems that we are facing and continue to face. So just speak a little bit about that, please.
Sure, definitely. I just want to say there is no difference between sexual history here and sexual history there. It's simply there is no sexual history here at all. Versus, I don't know if gynecologists do the sexual history bit, because I think they start seeing people who are married, right? And here, and a lot of the time sex is connected with marriage. So that's like a license to actually talk about it, at least in India. It was a few years ago when I was, you know, doing a student. So I don't think as venereologist or sexual health specialist, we could actually talk about sexual history at all. I think the gynecologist did that part, and that was associated with fertility and, you know, people being pregnant and, you know, what, and doing those, you know, those IVFs, and it went to that track of things. Oh. It was definitely not sexual health. And I really want to share this because, like I said, in a sexual health OPD, we have seen many, many 18-year-old or 19-year-old either with genital warts or herpes or vaginal discharge. And usually they present either with their mums or aunts or, you know, even elder siblings or something like that. Number one, there was no privacy. There's a big line of OPD standing, and there's this young girl sitting and whispering this to me. You know, there's no way I could ask anything. And I really don't think we could dare ask the 19-year-old girl, are you sexually active, when her mother is standing next to her? I don't think that's even a thing. She might beat me up, or she'll bring more people and beat me up. Or we could never ask. It was never...
I don't know if they would even have the language to talk about it. Do you think they would even have the language to... even if you want to ask...
Yeah, maybe we could have, but we did take them into a private room, you know, to examine them and then treat and stuff like that. Maybe we could have asked there. You know, we could have, definitely. And we were never taught. It was I don't think the textbook we read had all kind of STIs and beautiful images and everything, and symptoms and signs and treatment. I don't think there was a chapter called history taking at all. I don't think that was a thing. We never did that. Even like, you know, if there was an STI case presentation or something, that we would ask the age of the patient, yes, but it went off with asking things like, what color is the discharge? How long? You know, it becomes more subjective as to we're trying to establish a diagnosis as to whether this is chlamydia or gonorrhea. You know, that's what we're focusing on. What we have actually missed is, do you have a sexual partner? We've missed that. Are you having sex with one or many? We've missed that. And is that consensual or not? Is that a sexual assault that we are missing here? Is this sexual abuse that we are missing here? No. Mm-hmm. Is that domestic violence that we are missing here? No. We didn't ask any of this. It's retrospectively thinking, I do feel really like, you know, shameful to have, you know, not, I probably missed so many sexual, I don't know, assaults and abuse. And I could have also asked about contraception. You know, these girls are going to be pregnant someday and then probably go through some kind of, you know, natural abortion or termination, and which could be life-threatening. And I was reading the other day an article as to how many deaths are happening in India due to unnatural terminations and abortions. And that is an opportunity to say, if you're having a regular boyfriend or you're having sex, what's your form of contraception? You know, we did nothing. We did not. I mean, I'm very sure. I don't know how dermatology departments are run these days. I would really like to come and see if this has changed. But when I trained as a dermatologist, I did not take a sexual history. I'm not proud of it, but I did not do it. And then because of my venereology degree, I came here in Australia and I thought, okay, while I'm waiting to do a bit of derm work and stuff, let me join to whatever job I get. And I got the sexual health job. And then they said, oh, great, you know, and they said, do you want to just take sexual history for this patient? And, you know, my boss wanted to sit in. And then they had like a performa. It was like about 2 pages long, that sexual history. And I looked at it and I think it was really young girl, maybe 20, 21-year-old young girl, definitely not married. And I was thinking, I really had to really go and tell him, I have never done this in my life. Like he said, what? I thought you're a venereologist. I said, yes, I am. I am a venereologist. I know my STIs inside out, but I really do not know how to ask a 20-year-old these questions that you've written in this book. So the questions included things like, do you have sex with men, women, or both? Have you ever been forced to have any unwanted sex? So we can't use the word rape or, you know, assault, because those things are triggering words. Yes. And they really upset and disappoint people who have actually gone through it. So we have to be very subtle in our language. So our language is phrased very carefully. So we say, have you been forced to have any sex, or have you been had forced to have any unwanted sex? So we ask, you know, those questions. And other thing is, have you been ever hit or threatened by somebody at home? And that's your domestic violence screening question. And I don't think I've ever asked that ever to anyone back here at home, because considering the amount of domestic violence that's going on. And there were questions also about, do you do sex work? If only I asked that question to a 20-year-old back then, I don't know what they would do to me, to be honest. So, yeah. So do you do sex work? And then there's stuff like, do you have oral, vaginal or anal sex? And then there is stuff like, do you use toys or fingers or penis? And then there's like, do you use condom? Like the amount of detailed sexual history that booklet that I go through these days have is just, was unbelievable. It was shocking.
And is there comfort in asking those questions?
Absolutely.
And,
I think
getting those
answers.
An
attitude. I mean, absolutely.
So how do you create that safe space where the person in front of you is able to, I mean, you have to create that comfort and care and that safe space.
I think you have 2 minutes to create that, Smita, to be honest. You have a half an hour consultation. You have a young girl sitting in front of you, or a young boy. It could be a young, you know, any Asian background or Indian background, young gay boy sitting there in front of you. And you have exactly 2 minutes to gain his confidence. And I think it's an absolute art. I feel like the sexual health doctors here have absolutely nailed it. I should say each one of my colleague, we do it with so much ease. And we don't, I think in that 2 minutes, the first question is, do you have sex with men, women or both? Right? So the first question is, are you gay or straight? Right? So when you're asking that question without a whinge or without a smile, nothing, it's a question like saying, I'm not going to judge you. I don't care. You can tell me anything. I'm here to help you.
Brilliant.
Yeah. So I think that one question breaks the ice like so quickly. And the minute we do that and they see that our face is not winching or we're not doing that. And then every other question, fantastic. So let's do these tests. I think you're at a risk of this, this and this. Why don't we do this? And then we say, you know, HIV is highly risk about among gay men in, you know, Australia. So we talk about safe sex, and we also talk about PEP and PrEP, which is pre-exposure and post-exposure prophylaxis, which is available for gay men in Australia, which is free of cost. So we talk about all those kind of things without a whinge, without, you know, without judgment, without this. So we kind of designed in a way to make it as normalized as we can. And also with an attitude to say, honestly, we don't care. You know, we're here to help you, and whatever you're doing is normal. And a lot of the times we do have counselors. So we work with a team of counselors where we, you know, have so many people beating themselves up for either being gay or either, you know, being sexually active or getting an STI, and then all that guilt and stigma that comes along with it. And it's a long consultation. So I sometimes struggle to do, and I go past my time and do an hour of counseling. But I think that's very important. You know, I do run late where I have to run late. You know, when there is somebody falling apart and beating themselves up and having such low self-esteem because they are gay or because they come from a background, you know, there are people sometimes who come and say, you know, it's all because I didn't listen to my parents and I'm doing this. And I take a good 1 hour to talk to them, saying that has nothing to do with you. I mean, that's the way you are, and, you know, just boost the self-confidence and whatever, and also make sure they come in for regular counseling, because self-esteem and, you know, identity and sexuality and all that is very important.
Where your compassion comes in, right? This is the three words that you gave yourself. So that's a direct manifestation of the compassion there. Right.
So I feel like it's very important. It's such a sensitive topic. And the minute you do that, and the minute you provide that service to people, and I feel like, you know, they really appreciate it. It's needed. like where can they go and open up?
So Nivedita, just taking this forward a little bit, because when you're talking about the stigma about, you know, talking about your health, so whether it is vaginal discharge or it is syphilis, we don't want to get anything related to sexual, our sexual parts or sexual health for a checkup. We don't want to do that. Can you just talk a little bit about the impact of when we don't get ourselves tested and we just rely on either Google or porn or friends to get information and not get go to the right place and get ourselves treatment or information or test? What can be the further repercussions and impact on our health? Could you just talk about that a little bit?
So I think the most important part we have to know about STDs or STIs is 80% of the times they are asymptomatic. They don't have any symptoms. So if you think, you know, I am sexually active, but I don't have any symptoms, I'm okay, that is when you're wrong, because most of the STIs do not have any symptoms. So that's something that's very important for people to know. So if you don't have symptoms, it does not mean you don't have an STI. Right. So that's very important. And the second thing that people usually try to make a mistake is they always judge people's ability to have an STI or not, depending on their face value. So, you know, so a lot of the times the people say, oh, but he didn't look like he had an STI, or she didn't look like she will have an STI. You know, it's like, and sometimes I think, what is that look that you're actually looking for? You know, people don't walk around with STI written on their, you know, on their forehead, or what is that that you're thinking of, right? So definitely, please. I mean, the more don't think of a person's face and don't relate their ability to have an STI on whether they were good looking, clean, handsome, pretty. And so that is not connected. That's again very important. And the third thing is people think, oh, I have known this person. Oh, she's been a friend of mine for a very long time. She's lovely, right? Lovely has nothing to do with their ability of, again, whether they have an STI or not, right? So sexually transmitted infections or sex is not a character connection, right? Yes. So don't try to connect somebody's personality or somebody's morale with whether they can have sex or whether they are sexually active or whether they want to have sex. They are completely two different things. Okay. A person may be an absolutely loving person, kind, you know, generous, and they can be sexually active, and they probably like to have sex without a condom, and you don't know that. And so they might have a good chance of having STIs. So that has nothing to do with somebody's heart or personality or type they are. So I think we should stop connecting these things. These myths should be removed off. And the best way to know whether you have an STI or not is to get yourself regularly tested and checked. I always feel it is better late than never. So if you feel like you've been sexually active for a while and you've never been able to go and get a sexual health check, I think that's the best way to do it. Don't rely on anything else that I've just mentioned, the person's face or their quality or, you know, whether you have symptoms or not. So these three things are not really accurate of who has an STI or not. Testing is the best way.
I mean, knowing whether you have STI or not is, again, a later stage. I would say many of us, many, many women or queer folks with vaginas, they don't understand their own genitalia. And I saw one of the reels that you had just done where you did all the yes and the no's. Please talk a little bit about that, because I think that's really important information to have about how to make your vagina smell better or not, or whether you need to douche it or not. Just talk a little bit about that, please.
Yes, definitely. See, I think it's a very important topic how everybody is having a lot of time now and everybody is talking about self-exploring and things like that, which is great. And in that process, I think people have started noticing that the vagina is smelling different, and there's a lot of products in the market that's come up as well. And a lot of people have also started noticing that the vaginal skin color is a bit different to the other body parts. And with a lot of laser treatment available these days, a lot of people want to have their, you know, their pubic hair removed. And I think they can get a better view of the skin underneath, all the folds and bends and how different, you know, vulval skins and everything is a bit more clearly seen. And I feel like they are trying to overdo things now, to be honest. So this is why I made that video. And what yes. I was trying to say is that we have to understand that the vagina, that is the bit inside, is a self-cleaning organ, and it has both good bacteria and bad bacteria. So when we try to use a soap that is scented or wash, we are washing away all the bacteria, independent of whether it's good or bad, right? And the good bacteria actually produces lactic acid and keeps the vagina acidic. So it takes care of itself. And you, by washing it off with soap, is actually destroying it. So when you destroy that acidity, you start growing other stuff in it, and it starts smelling. And then you think, oh, it's smelling, I should wash. And then you do it over and over again. So it becomes like a vicious cycle. You know, you wash and clean, smells bad, wash and clean, smells bad. So the whole thing of washing on the inside with, you know, perfumed products, or douching, as we call it, spraying water inside your vagina, is actually a no-no. You shouldn't be doing it at all, not even in moderation. It's not necessary. If you feel like after sex you want to go and have a wash, you can wash on the outside and you can pee straight away. Actually, peeing straight after sex is good for women because, you know, of UTIs and things like that. So if you pee it out, there's nothing going inside the urethra, which is very close to the vagina. So that's a good way of actually doing that. And the other thing I've noticed is there are people who are trying to use bleach down there to make the skin down there look fairer. But I really want to say that the skin down there is very sensitive. It is so much more thinner than the skin on your face and hand. And it absorbs the chemicals that you put there much more than how the face or stuff will absorb. So your allergic reactions, the burn will be happening more often in the vaginal skin. So it is not a good idea to bleach your skin, and the skin there is going to be darker, doesn't no matter how much you bleach. Also, because it is in a part which is compressed by the two thighs, so you have both your thighs on either side of your vaginal, and you do the friction that goes like that. So it's not something abnormal. And if you same thing, if you use notice with men, the scrotal skin, you know, is a bit more darker, and the area in between the scrotum and the bum is a bit more darker, and that's due to constant sweat and friction. And honestly, bleaching that area has no purpose, and it's really very harmful because the skin there, thin, both even like the scrotal skin for men or vaginal skin, they are really thin, and it really absorbs these things back. So bleaching, I have had a few girls say, you know, it's different, I've tried bleach, and bleach is a no-no. Don't please put bleach down there. And apparently in market, now there are vaginal masks. So you have masks that you can, I think this is all with the amount of time that people have at home sitting and doing this now. So there are vaginal masks. I mean, I don't think you need to use the vaginal mask. It's just fine. And the skin that, you know, the floppy bits you have down there is different for every individual. So don't Google and get scared saying mine does not look perfectly, or mine doesn't look like the one the porn star has. To be honest, porn is an unrealistic expectation of real life. It's like watching a Marvel movie, because people are flying and people are jumping from one building to another, and Spider-Man is, you know, swinging in his spider, and you know, it's what it, please consider porn as any other paid, you know, one of the Avenger or Marvel movies or Disney movies that is happening, because you really, you know, in your real life, you will not be jumping off cliffs or jumping off, you know, with Spider-Man, and you won't be going, you're not superhero, right? Porn is exactly like that. Porn is a paid movie where people are starring, and it's not real. People go through extreme of having surgeries, and you know, and the whole sexual encounter in a porn is not one complete encounter. In fact, I don't think that is pleasurable in many cases, right?
Yeah, it's amazing. So sex is, we can have a long conversation on porn again, because apart from dehumanizing everything.
Absolutely. Is, so don't compare yourself with anything that is happening on porn, and you just be yourself. You are yourself. And there are like the sexual health sites, which we have put a lot of pictures about how different kind of vaginas and vulvas can look and their colors and stuff like that. So if you want to refer those things, please do refer things like that. Mm. You just be happy with yourself. And I think that is very important. And looking at the mirror or feeling that you're looking beautiful or building that self-confidence, that is fantastic. And when you feel like you're having sex or even like foreplay or kissing or anything, a sexual partner that you really love and you're having those butterflies, that's all it is about. That's all sex is about, to be honest. It doesn't have to be a porn perfect, whatever that is that they're depicting. It doesn't have to be that at all.
Lovely, thanks. You know, 11 years, right? You've been doing this for 11
yes,
years?
Yes, I have.
So what has been the most fascinating part of this whole journey? 11 years, if you were to just share something with us about that.
Something fun or something serious?
Both.
Okay.
We have about we have 6 minutes left with us, so feel free
okay,
to give me
perfect.
What.
So, yeah. I mean, with exciting things, I think I can say a lot. Like my whole job is exciting. And a lot of the times when I am looking at really gross things into people's bums or swabbing people's bums and, you know, and I'm doing that without a whinge on my face and making them feel as comfortable as I can. And when people ask me, did you really choose to do this? Do you want to do this every day? And I look at them and I say, yes, because I wake up in the morning and come purely to listen to people's sex lives. I mean, it can't be that difficult, really. You know. So we have a joke about it, and I feel like this is something I love, and to make it sound like a non-judgmental thing, being able to provide what I do, you know, always with a laugh, and you know, just we laugh about it, we break the tension or we break the guilt or shame just so quickly, you know.
Brilliant.
And it's brilliant. Yeah, I love to just break it off and say, yeah, that's it, we're not gonna fuss about this, come on, let's get over it, you know, life's more than this. And yeah, so I like doing that, so that's something I really enjoy in my job day to day. And another thing which has been very eye-opening experience for me is to see, like I said, really young 14 to 16 year old children, either sexually assaulted or pregnant and going through termination and, you know, and have left home or living in broken families and then have started or being addicted to drugs, you know, and not able to attend school and stuff. So those things has really shaken me as a person, even to appreciate the little things that we have. And, you know, it's helped me be a better person. It's helped me be a better mom, to be honest.
Yes.
And I'm really grateful to be able to help these children. And I will call them children. They call them young youth, but to me they are. You know, able to help them with contraception and, you know, just making sure that they don't fall pregnant and able to provide them with safe, you know, help them find safe housing or able to bring them to detox, you know, with alcohol and drugs. And let's just to help through the journey. You know, sometimes, you know, we've seen people that I've diagnosed when I started off like 10, 11 years ago. And then now they've, you know, grown up and you feel grateful if you've played a role in just making them into an adult, help them finish even school, making sure they don't fall pregnant again so they don't go through termination, just little things. So being able to play that role in that kind of a growing adult for who these people are really, really grateful for, I think that's such a blessing.
So it's just like a full circle with your kind, compassionate giving. Like you started with those three words, which were just words. And at the end of it, when I'm listening to you, it's really those words coming to life for me in understanding how you're living your life. And I would very quickly like to share, because this is so much in sync with what we are trying to do over here in Nivedita. We are running a countrywide program working with 18 to 22 year olds and enabling them with information so that they in turn can actually within their families have conversations. So we are giving them information and education and skill and language so that they within their family can then talk to the adults and then talk to also the children about consent, about personal boundaries, about no, about grooming, about just the body parts, about naming your genitalia, about being able to talk about sex, sexuality, and sexual health. We can actually bring in this whole positive, enabled conversation, talking space, which will make child sexual abuse within the family recede. Because we're able to talk about things like this. We don't have to keep quiet about them anymore. And so every single thing that you have shared with us over here is so relevant to all the work that we are doing. And
you're doing fantastic work, Smita, I should say. And, you know, it's just great. I think our country needs it. And like you said, education and language and normalizing this is important. And like I said, just trust building, you know, a lot of the time people don't say because they're worried about what the other person is going to think, you know, they don't come out. And I think that's fantastic. And I think counseling is also very important. It should be there. Because a lot of the time people are not able to share it with their own family members.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So if they have a third person and they know that it is confidential and they're not being judged, I think it's a great way to say that part of my family, but I can, you know, express myself in a confidential way.
So we're going to draw upon you and your promise that you want to give back to your country. And we're going to come back to you and take this forward with a conversation. Every Sunday, we also have a webinar, which is at 3 o'clock, 3 p.m. India time, which is I think like a startup session for anybody who wants to become part of our movement and contribute in one way or the other. It's what we call like your orientation or the starting point. Our program is called the Rakshin Project. For us, Rakshin is a person who is committed to preventing harm. So if you want to be a Rakshin and join the movement to prevent harm, sexual harm, come for our webinar at 3 o'clock on a Sunday.
Perfect. I'm going to make a note. I'm going to be there for a webinar this Sunday.
I will send you the link for that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It was absolutely lovely talking to you. And I'm so happy you connected.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you very much. All the very best to you for your work that you're doing.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Smita. Same to you.